afternoon. Please take your seat. It's a real pleasure and a honor to introduce Matoshi Koshiba, Nobel Prize 2002, to speak about the birth of neutrino astrophysics. I would like to say a few words to introduce to you and to recall to the younger people what Toshi has represented for particle physics. Toshi Koshiba graduated in 1955 at Rochester with a thesis on ultra-high energy phenomena in cosmic rays. And 1955 is a turning point in the history of particle physics. It was the years where particle physicists were turning from cosmic rays, where Toshi was working, to particle accelerators. I have to recall you that CERN was created in 1954, and the big accelerators were starting. So that's the real beginning of particle physics, which Koshiba has followed from the very beginning. He has been research associate in Chicago University, from 55 to 58, and then a long career in the University of Tokyo, where completely dedicated to teaching and research. It is usually said that professor at University of Tokyo first become rector and then ministers, but Toshi has stayed with us for all the time, and I think we have to be grateful for that. There is a long list of prizes and recognitions I'm not going to tell you, just mention Academy of Japan, American Physical Society, European Physical Society, but one has stricken my imagination, the Order of Cultural Merit conferred personally by the Emperor of Japan. I think it's a great honor. Toshi was one, perhaps the one, that promoted the participation of Japan physicists to LEP in OPAL, and since then has been a great friend of CERN. I'm sad to say that we'd like very much to have here with us also another friend of CERN, which was Professor Orita, who disappeared recently. And Toshi spent 1 year in Geneva, 87-88, as a guest professor, and visited DAISY and many European and US institutions. In fact, he's a very good friend of us. But the thing for which he is universally recognized is the creation of Kamiokande, Kamioka Nucleon Decay Experiment, a completely new facility which at the time seemed rather extraordinary and was designed to detect, as the name says, the proton decay. Proton did not decay, at least until now, but Kamioka could be converted into a wonderful neutrino observatory. The first was the neutrinos from supernova, 23rd February 1987. Everybody was excited to learn that a stream of neutrinos had been detected at the same time in two underground observatories, Kamioka and IMB. Then the observation of solar neutrinos, the first time one could see solar neutrinos with events pointing directly to the sun, unlike the chemical detectors that were used since then, a confirmation of solar neutrino deficit, and then the experiments on the atmospheric neutrinos and the discovery of a deficit of muon neutrinos versus electron neutrinos. Kamioka had also spin-offs, which were not foreseen at the beginning. One is K2K, long baseline beam from KK to Kamioka, and Kamland, a most recent experiment which has detected the neutrinos from diffuse sources of nuclear reactors and has confirmed the large mixing angle solution of solar neutrino. In fact, Kamioka's story, very successful story, is a proof that physics indeed is an experimental science. good facilities can do much more than theorists can say, and much more than committees can approve. With Kamioka and his continuation, Super Kamiokande, Toshi has given a fundamental contribution to the understanding of neutrino mass and oscillations, and for that he has been rewarded last year with the Nobel Prize in Physics together with Raymond Davis Jr. for pioneering contributions to astrophysics, in particular for the detection of cosmic neutrinos, and the third one was Riccardo Giacconi in a different field for pioneering contribution to astrophysics, which have led to the discovery of cosmic X-ray sources. Particle physics can still deserve surprises and can still deserve Nobel Prizes. I think we will continue with that. So with that, I would stop, and it's a pleasure to give Toshi the floor for his talk. Thank you very much. Okay.
Hello. Come to think of it, exactly 43 years ago, I came to CERN here. I organized international collaboration meeting here in CERN based on the advice of Professor Occhialini. So that was my first contact with CERN. After that, some years later, as Director General mentioned in his introduction, our younger people gained quite a lot of experience in collaboration with a European physicist on collider experiment. First at DESI, working on DASP and J, and then came to CERN to work on OPAL. And they are now preparing for ATLAS. Well, for which I should like to thank you all. Now, the talk I'm going to give today is almost the same as the Nobel lecture I gave at Stockholm University 7 months ago. Now, I am to talk about the birth of neutrino astrophysics. But before a baby is born, he has to be conceived first. That's quite true. Now, the baby was conceived, I think, by the work of Raymond Davis. He did radiochemical experiment using cleaning liquid containing chlorine 37. This chlorine 37, when it is hit by electron neutrino, changes into argon 37, which is a radioactive nucleus. Davis collected once in a month by sending bubble of helium into this liquid, collecting a very small number of argon 37, and then try to measure the decay back of this argon 37 nucleus. After so many years of tedious measurement, he concluded that solar neutrino comes only one third of what theoretical people tell you. Only one third. Well, this difference is too large to be explained away by some mistake in the experimental procedure or anything. So this is a big puzzle, and people started talking about flavor change, of neutrinos between Sun and the Earth. And as a matter of fact, this result was in my mind when I was starting to think about solar neutrino observation by a different method. If there were not this result by Raymond Davis, I wouldn't seriously think about solar neutrino observation. So this was actually a vital impetus for us to work on solar neutrino. The experiment I am to talk about today are two. First one is Kamiokande. Kamioka is the name of the town where it is located. NDE stands for Nucleon Decay Experiment. However, without finding any nucleon decay, we have been reporting only on neutrinos. People started interpreting it neutrino detection experiment. It's all right with me. It is a type which might be called imaging water Cherenkov detector. Here also experimental people use a lot of Cherenkov counters. But this one at Kamiokande, we call it imaging water Cherenkov. I will show you why we call it that way. This one costed a moderate amount of $3 million. And this was considered from the very beginning as a feasibility experiment on the astrophysical observation of solar neutrino. Well, thanks to the result obtained here at CERN, we already had very good theory. Weak interaction unified with electromagnetic interaction and also combined with a strong interaction. We had what we call standard theory of elementary particles. So we could calculate all the weak processes, including neutrino electron scattering. Okay. If there was not discoveries like neutral current or Zizel or W plus minus, we couldn't be sure whether Kamiokande is big enough to make this feasibility experiment on the astrophysical observation of solar neutrino. But we could calculate how many events we could expect every week with this detector. Okay, so we decided to go ahead. All right. The second experiment is much bigger. It's called Super Kamiokande. The amount contained in this detector is 50,000 tons of water. It has a better light sensitivity than Kamiokande, but it costed much more. This Super Kamiokande was meant to be the real astrophysical observatory of solar neutrino. Okay? Now, this is a inside of the Kamiokande through a fish eye lens. The yellow point are all photomultipliers, total of a little bit more than 1,000. You know, when we were planning this Kamiokande experiment, originally for searching nucleon decay, next month I heard there is a much bigger, similar experiment being prepared in the United States, which later is called IMB, Irvine, Michigan, and Brookhaven. Now, both IMB and I were thinking of using off-the-shelf photomultiplier of 5-inch diameter. Okay? If we do the same thing, much bigger IMB will find the nucleon decay first, and what do I do with smaller detector? So, I had to think very, very seriously, how to compete with this big brother in the United States. Of course, once you got research fund, you cannot increase by factor of 2 or 3 without producing any result yet. Therefore, for a given budget amount, you have to find a way to compete with this big brother. Then I came to the conclusion that in order to keep the budget at the same level, we cannot increase the channel number, okay? Then the only thing we can do is to make one channel sensitivity much bigger, okay? Therefore, instead of 5-inch phototube, I wanted to have 20-inch diameter phototube, which did not exist in the world. So I called a company in Japan, which had years of collaboration with our group, including the JD experiment and OPA experiment. It's called Hamamatsu Photonics. And I finally talked the president of this company to work together to develop this really big phototube. Well, this big phototube was nicely developed within 1 year, and I was so happy. Now, this is the inside of Super Kamiokande, and here you can see many more big phototubes, total of more than 11,000. Now, because not many people, including the neutrino physicists here at CERN, don't know the performance of this type of detector, I'll show you some example. First example is a muon produced by cosmic rays in the atmosphere and reaching 1,000 meters underground. This is Super Kamiokande. It's like a big tin can. You cut vertically at the side and open it flat, and top lid opened up, bottom pulled down. So you can see the inside of Super Kamiokande here. And this. Great. Each dot here represents a big phototube. Red dot implies a phototube received large number of photons. Yellow ones, smaller number of photons received. And muon just entered the detector here, okay? 50 nanoseconds later, Cherenkov light is emitted like this. And this is the trajectory of the muon. This, by the way, is a time profile of the total number of photons. Another 50 nanoseconds later, Cherenkov light reached this front, while the muon, which travels faster than the light velocity in the water, already reached the bottom and lit large number of photon multipliers here. Another 50 nanoseconds, Cherenkov light also reached the bottom. Another 50 nanoseconds, it filled the entire detector. Okay, this way, just like in a very slow motion picture, you can observe the behavior of charged particle, right? Now, not only that, this detector for a stopping particle, muon was produced in the detector, in the water, and then stopped. Then you get a very crisp Cherenkov ring. Okay? Electron was produced in the water and stopped in the water, also produced a Cherenkov ring. But you can see that in this case, the photon is scattered, diffused, compared to the case of muon. This is, of course, you people already know that electron in water produces electromagnetic cascade in which large number of low energy electrons and positrons are produced. They are scattered away. And Cherenkov light they produce will be different from the original direction. Okay? Therefore, by analyzing the radial distribution of these photons, quantitatively, we can make very clear-cut distinction between muon event and electron event. The error probability of this distinction is less than 1%. So you can be sure that you can make a good separation. This, by the way, was a decisive factor for us to discover later the anomaly in the atmospheric neutrino. Now, there are four accomplishments the old Kamio Kande did. First is what might be termed astrophysical observation, which means directional information and timing information and energy spectrum information. All those three information included. This I would call astrophysical observation. Okay, how we did it? Solar neutrino scattered off electron in the water. Okay, since electron has a small rest mass, when it is hit by say 10 MeV neutrino, almost dead forward, electrons start moving. So by observing this electron, by means of Cherenkov ring it produces, as you saw in previous example, we can infer the direction, timing, and the energy spectrum of the incoming neutrinos. Now, when we decided to do this solar neutrino observation, we had to spend a year and a half in deducing the environmental background and in cleanings of water as much as possible and so forth. And then finally, January 1st of 1987, our Kamikande was calm enough and ready to take data on solar neutrinos. So we started data taking. Less than 2 months after January 1st, there was a telephone call and fax from all over the world saying there appeared a supernova explosion in the southern sky. Do you see the neutrino signal in your detector? So we looked at the data of the day, and very easy to find the supernova neutrino signal, because supernova signal is much easier to observe than solar neutrino, right? Because they are considerably larger in energy, and not only that, they are bunched in time, short time period. Okay? So it's much easier. I'll show it to you later. Now, third, this old Kamikande, as I said, did discover the anomaly in the atmospheric neutrino. As I showed you, this detector could make good distinction between mu event and E event. That means by counting the number of mu event produced in the water, in the detector, and number of electron event produced in the detector, you compare the number, okay? That is directly proportional to the number ratio of nu mu and nu e. A very simple calculation shows you that this number, nu mu over nu e, has to be 2 to 1. Okay? However, the observed ratio is 1 to 1. This is certainly a funny thing. But the observation was only a little bit more than 4 sigma of significance. So we could not convince everybody in the world. And then I'll describe our solar neutrino observation. And this is a theoretically expected solar neutrino energy spectrum and flux. And this part is energy region our detector can observe. And this is a region Ray Davis radiochemical experiment can detect. As I said, Kamikande is feasibility experiment of the astrophysical observation of solar neutrino. So you can see this isotropic background due to environmental radioactivity. You can see some event coming from the direction of the sun to the earth. Yeah, not many, but when we compare the energy spectrum of recoil electron, this energy spectrum of recoil electron has one-to-one correspondence to the original neutrino energy spectrum. Okay? So, expected energy spectrum normalized, and you can see that the shape is not very much different from the expected energy spectrum, but intensity is only one half. So we can confirm the result of Ray Davis. Now I come to the solar neutrino observation. Supernova neutrino. As I said, from the very beginning of 87, we started data taking of solar neutrino, because after all, we finally reduced the background here, okay? And then, very soon, we observed this signal of supernova neutrino. This is a background, okay? And this is a supernova neutrino bunched signal. Only 11 events altogether. But this is the first observation of supernova neutrino and gave very good support to the theoretical idea of gravitational collapse of iron core for the trigger of supernova type 2 explosion. Okay? Now come to the atmospheric neutrino anomaly. As I said, you don't have to make detailed Monte Carlo simulation. Now, when a high energy cosmic clay hit atmosphere and produces pion and kaon in the upper atmosphere, those mesons decay into muon and mu nu. You get only nu mu here. When the secondary muons decay into electrons, then you get nu mu and nu e. So if this series of events happen, you get two nu mu against one nu e. Okay? So the ratio, number ratio is 2 to 1. When the energy is higher, some muon don't decay. As you saw in the previous example, some muon, high energy muon, reaches our detector underground. When that happens, you don't get this additional nu mu and nu e, and you get only nu mu. So the ratio is larger than 2. Okay? Now, what is the experimental observation? This is normalized to theoretical value of almost 2, and Kamiokande data of various energies, yeah, and IMB American data all gave about half the theoretical value. The reason why we couldn't convince many physicists is probably because there are European experiments which did say that it is consistent with the expectation, right? However, later, Super Kamiokande, with significance of more than 9 sigma, confirmed this anomaly. And this, by the way, is oscillation parameters, delta M square and mixing error, as determined by the original old Kamiokande data. Okay? Now, the bigger Super Kamiokande accomplished 3 things. Established the solar neutrino observation with much better statistics. Firmly established at more than 9 sigma, the non-zero masses of neutrinos and their oscillations. Now, I don't talk about nucleon decay. Well, you can compare this result with the previously shown old Kamiokande data. Super Kamiokande, because of it's much bigger size and much better sensitivity, has much cleaner directional observation of solar neutrinos. Yeah? Number is very much larger. Now that we can make this directional observation of solar neutrino, instead of taking images of the sun by photons, which you call photographs, why don't we use neutrinos to make the image of the sun, which you might call neutrino graph or new graph? This is new graph of the sun, okay? This thing here is the orbit of the sun in the galactic coordinate, as seen by its neutrino. Well, this is nice, but when you look at it carefully, this sun is very much bigger than what you usually see in the photograph. This is, of course, our directional observation of the solar neutrino has very poor angular resolution, unfortunately. Well, younger people here in some years may improve the resolution here to get a better neutrino graph of the sun. Well, this is the spectral observation by Super-Kamio Kande to be compared with the theoretical expectation. And detailed comparison here was very useful in pinpointing the oscillation parameters of solar neutrino. Okay? Now, atmospheric neutrino did show the anomaly in the number ratio of nu mu and nu e. If this is indeed due to the oscillation of nu mu into some other neutrino, the amount of this oscillation would depend on the distance between its production and its detection. Yeah? Now, when we observe neutrino coming from a world, those neutrino were produced only 20 kilometers above our detector. When it came horizontally to our detector, it means 1,000 kilometers away it was produced. Okay? When it comes from the bottom, it was produced 13,000 kilometers away. So there was a very big difference. We should see the difference in the amount of oscillation. Now, in the case of electron event, you don't see any difference from the expected distribution. But in the case of muon, okay, this is the direction coming from the top, this is coming from the bottom. Always in this region, you see a very large deficit. Okay? So this is a very direct proof that indeed nu mu is changing into something else. Now, neutrino oscillation is something which is not easy to grasp, but you should recognize the very elementary things. In quantum mechanics, For instance, when there are only two kinds of neutrinos, okay, only two kinds of neutrinos, the state of neutrino can be specified by two basic functions, wave functions. This basic wave function could be the wave function which diagonalizes the mass matrix, or it could be the ones which diagonalizes the weak interaction Hamiltonian. In the latter case, the basic vector would be new mu state and new tau state, for instance. In the former case, the basic vector could be M1 mass state and M2 mass state, right? These two representations are equivalent. Yeah? It can be converted from one to the other. Now, the key point is this. When you express, for instance, new mu state in terms of M1 state and M2 state, okay? This M1 state and M2 state has a characteristic frequency proportional to total energy of these two states. When the time frequency of these two states is very close, small difference, then they start making beat by which one amplitude becomes slowly bigger while the other becoming slowly smaller and changes like this, you know? This causes the change of pure mu nu state into some mixture of new tau state. And this is a solar neutrino oscillation parameters as determined by Super Kamiokande combined with US Canadian joint experiment at called SNOW. And this one combined all the solar neutrino data, including Ray Davis and others' gallium data. So you can see there is only one possible allowed region of oscillation parameter in the case of solar neutrino. Now, non-zero mass of those neutrinos have been firmly established. What does this mean? It means rather serious thing. First of all, you have to change the standard theory, which assumed all neutrinos at zero mass. And not only that, popular SU5 symmetry has to be discarded. There are nice things which I did not expect. That is, at very low energies, when neutrino did have non-zero rest masses, yeah, such neutrino can become non-relativistic. Then, such low energy neutrinos get total refraction by superconducting walls. This is very, very nice possibility, because as you saw in our observation of solar neutrino, The arrival direction of neutrino is very, very difficult to determine. But when such neutrino does make total reflection, then we can make a parabolic mirror by superconducting wall to focus very accurately the low energy neutrinos. Then you, most of you people already know that by observing the, what is called cosmic microwave background with very good angular resolution intensity, people are now observing the state of our universe about 10 to 5 years after its birth, right? We are now observing the state of our universe, of that young stage. If we can observe what might be called cosmic neutrino background with good angular resolution, with good sensitivity, we can observe our universe only 1 second after its birth. This is really nice possibility. However, mind you, the detection of such low energy neutrino is really difficult thing. If some of you young people get involved in this, you can easily waste your 30 years. Be careful. Now, I have to tell you the newest result from Kamioka. Okay? It's called Kamlan, the third generation experiment at Kamioka. It has observed anti-electron neutrino emitted by atomic power reactor about 200 kilometers away. And it did observe the oscillation of this anti-electron neutrino. The oscillation parameter happened to be the same as the electron neutrino oscillation we observed for solar neutrino. So this is very nice. Now, one thing which amuses me is that, as I said, in Kamioka, there's already third generation experiment working. Third generation physicists are getting PhD from Kamioka experiment, and I'm very happy. Not only that, for instance, this Kamlan experiment was, of course, proposed and financed by Japanese government physicists, but number of collaborators, 50 American physicists against 30 Japanese physicists. And Super Kamiokande contains more than 80 American physicists. So altogether, in Kamioka, there are more than 130 American collaborators taking a turn to take data and so forth. And some people call Kamioka a mecca of neutrino research, which makes me very happy. Now, future possibilities. You know, as we saw in our observation of supernova neutrinos, neutrino burst occurs 3 or 4 hours ahead of optical outburst. So this is very nice, all right? So if we had Super Kamiokande-like detector, say, 4 of them distributed over the Earth with good timing, then when supernova occurs in our galaxy, this timing will tell you very accurately where to look at for the coming flare-up of supernova. You know, the astronomers never observe the very early stage of supernova flare-up. Only after it leads to some very bright stage, they point their telescope to that direction and start observing. But this real beginning, they can, for the first time, make observation. Now, there's one more very nice possibility. You know, recently, quite often I was asked, what is a good use of neutrinos? Well, I don't know. Maybe in 100 years, people might find some use of neutrinos. But this success of Kamlan in observing anti-electron neutrino from the atomic pile opens up very nice use. For instance, volcano thermal energy in the Earth. The original energy source is radioactive deposit, uranium or thorium, somewhere in the Earth. Okay? Those radioactive material emit anti-electron neutrino. Okay, then when you distribute Kamlan type detector over the Earth, then you can do what I would call anti-neutrino natural emission tomography of the Earth, so that you can tell where, how much uranium and thorium are deposited here, and how much here, and so forth. This, I think, is a very nice application of neutrino detection. Now, I don't know whether I should tell you this or not, but you know, we observe the non-zero masses of neutrinos, and we get only delta M square and mixing angle. But using some model like seesaw mechanism and so forth, we can produce mass spectrum consistent with the observed delta M square. Well, being an experimentalist, when I look at this, well, there's some regularity, but can't I do a little bit better? All right? It's better. What I did is to give mass boost of only 6.070 MeV to all the electrically charged particles. It is a straight line from first family to second family, and from second family to the third family. So there should be some mathematical operator connecting to these different families. But as I said before, young people, don't spend too much time on this, because this is the only one possible mass spectrum. I thank you for your patience. Thank you very much.